So, thank you very much for coming to my talk. Today we will talk about page object pattern or page object model or how whenever you will call that. The concept is the same. And the thing that I will talk about is not the best solutions. It's just solutions that I get during my 7-year experience working in the big company. So, I'm Sargis. Nice to see all of you. I have more than 7 years experience working with the Selenium and automation quality assurance. And most of my experience I got working when I was working it, with Workfront, which is the US-based company. And let's go and see what I prepared for you today. So, yep, it's from the screen, it's squeezed a bit. But anyway, we'll have a like short introduction, then we'll talk about page object pattern. I don't want to go details in a low level. I will try to explain some stuff in a bit of high level. And we will talk about what kind of the weight opportunities we have in the Selenium. And then the most fun part, the challenging part, is the loadable component and the slow loadable component that will help us to get right from the weights in the Selenium. And I will talk about the common failures that people were always asking me questions about that, and how to do and how to not do. And then we are a bit short of time. I hope we'll have a time for the question and answer. If not, I will be around till the end of the conference. Thank you very much for coming to my talk. Today we will talk about page object pattern or page object model or how whenever you will call that. The concept is the same. And the thing that I will talk about is not the best solutions. It's just solutions that I get during my 7-year experience working in the big company. So, I'm Sargis. Nice to see all of you. I have more than 7 years experience working with the Selenium and automation quality assurance, and most of my experience I got working when I was working it with Workfront, which is the US-based company. And let's go and see what I prepared for you today. So, yep, it's from the screen, it's squeezed a bit. But anyway, we'll have a like short introduction, then we'll talk about page object pattern. I don't want to go details in a low level. I will try to explain some stuff in a bit of high level. And we will talk about what kind of the weight opportunities we have in the Selenium. And then the most fun part, the challenging part, is the loadable component and the slow loadable component that will help us to get right from the weights in the Selenium. And I will talk about the common failures that people were always asking me questions about that, and how to do and how to not do. And then we are a bit short of time. I hope we'll have a time for the question and answer. If not, I will be around till the end of the conference. No, this is not good already. Can some technical guy help us with this? I see normal in my screen, but there is problem. It will become a bit smaller, but what to do? So, demos that I will provide will be coded in Java. And as example, I use the GitHub UI interface And we will try to log in and try that there is exception or something like that. Everything that I will present will be applicable in strong type language, for example, if you are using a C#. And most of things will be applicable also in dynamic type languages like Ruby, Python, or something. So also in my presentations, I will use Maven, Test Engine, and for sure Selenium. So everyone has the basic knowledge of this. So, page object pattern. I will know again, like high level to remember what is it if someone is some out of information. It's a framework design pattern which has become popular in the Selenium test automation, and it makes easier to maintain and reduce the code duplication. This is for as Selenium, like when we are automating like web application, and it makes easier to create page, maintain page, and whenever we would like to do it with the pages. And let's imagine we have a web application, and there is a different pages, login page, like registration page, some stuff. And in page pattern, also in the pages, there is a services like different, like specific for that page. So what we are doing, we are collecting every single page will be presented as a class, and the web page will be object. There is a classes, and every class will contain the elements with their services and the methods. So why we need to use it? This is the important question. It promotes reuse and of the code, so we'll have less code. It makes readable the whole suite. Also, it improves maintainability, so it's easy to maintain. Makes easy to change the classes, and you will not change anything in the test class. So if you have page objects in every class name change or something that developers will change, you will change just once in one place. So how it's structured? Each page is defined its own class. Actions and are represented in the class as a method and our functions. Each function can return new page object, especially when we are navigating between the page pages. Tests talks only with the page objects. Page objects, this is like extra step that I added, like with the base objects. A lot of people call that the abstract page base objects is whenever you call. And base objects talks to driver. Elements are stored as a variables. So we should make sure we should make sure that the Selenium talks only with the page objects, especially with the base class. So when we are changing something, it will be easier. So in a graphical appearance, it will look like this. So this is just a Selenium with the tests and the browsers and the report and the web application. When we are adding the page objects, so where it should be? Yeah. So we are isolating tests to be interaction with the Selenium. And another extra step that I will suggest to add, and a lot of like specialists will suggest to do, it's adding one more step between Selenium and the page objects. Like to collect everything. This is some abstract class in Java. And this is a way to make it easier to collect everything in there. So this is also a kind of a place to collect some methods that will be interacting with the Selenium. So type or finding element instead of every time calling it from driver. Because I had a problem when we were upgrading Selenium versions, so usually there is solution that should be applied to the type. So instead of going to every page objects and changing the type, we are going to the base class and changing there. So in other appearance, it will look like layers. So which one In this graphic, you can see that the main concept is this layer should not be able to talk to with this layer. So every layer can and should talk with neighbors. There should not be any allowance to jump from that layer to the layer. This is how it looks in the packages in the Java for the Maven project. And it's a bit, again, cut it, but sorry. It's not my fault. Yep. This is basically how that page objects looks like. Here is the just example, so I hard coded the main URL. So in the real world, we are not doing this. Yes, collecting something in the property file and then reading from there to make it easier. Just being a bit more understandable and readable, I did it. And there is a constructor which is applying that driver. I will show where I am creating the driver. And here is the open page, which always you will use when you are starting the test. And this is an abstract, and it can become any type of the page that you will extend it. Here, okay, for this get, maybe you have a question why there is a get. We will talk about that in a loadable component because it's done for that. And there is some abstract methods, and you can add more. So because every page will have a get URL, so we are putting in a page objects and then overriding them for the specific page. And open is already been easy. So this is the continuation of the page objects. I make it like two part to be more readable. I collected here like find, type, like different types of type. Like loaded methods, click, also some several type, and some methods that you are always using. This is just for the example because I know everyone like using this because the method of the is displayed throws exception when there is no. So this is a kind of the exception handling example, and you can add more based on your application. Here. There is a Selenium driver class which done like high level stuff like creating driver, and it's collected in a separate class. Here I'm just creating, I'm checking that it's not null then creating, and I created a static method, and I can call from everywhere, which makes for me easier than always creating for every page. And I have a base test class, and every test class extends this, so as a becoming a subclass of this. And here I'm doing any stuff that done for every test. For example, after finishing class all the tests, just close the browser. Here you can add, for example, after finishing, like clear all cookies, or anything globally you want to them, because to add and repeat in the classes, I don't like that. There's no make sense. So generally, this is the test that looks like this just small test that trying to log into GitHub and with the wrong credentials and shows that there is no such user and checking that exception. Not exception, but error message. So weights in Selenium. How many of you have a problem with the weights? How many of you using the sleeps? Yeah. How many of you like using the retry? I mean, if doesn't work, retry once, always. So for the basic weights, I will generally show you which kind of the weights options that there is in the Selenium. Then we'll talk about a loadable component, which is created for this purpose, to solve this problem. So why we are waiting? To load the page, to make it ready, and to make the old transactions. And I always say that the slips, there shouldn't be slip, because it's always making a hard time, not adjustable. And when we are running on a continuous integration in the Amazon services, which is too expensive, we are losing a lot of money. Actually, company lose, but. So, Selenium offers like three types of the weights: implicit weight, explicit weight, and the fluent weight. This is the three versions that you can use without anything. So, implicit weight, this is the amount that you are giving to the Selenium configs, saying that every time when you are getting the any element, wait for X time, like 10 seconds. And the problem here, when there is no an element and you are checking that there shouldn't be any element, it still waits the 10 seconds. So this is not adjustable. Also, it's undocumented. It only works for finding the elements, and you cannot customize anything. You are setting up for the driver, and it's non-visible, but it's like driver manage, timeout, or explicit weight, and then you are giving the weight. The best practice is to not use this. If you have possibility, if you have, you can manage without it, it's a good thing to not use this one. So, explicit weight. Here is, we have a documented and defined behavior, so you can also read in the website. This, what is is doing, it's from like every 500 milliseconds, it's pinging to application, checking, pinging, checking until it will find. And it's returns success or timeout, which you can define, and works any condition you can provide. So this visible, this clickable, this should be disabled, anything you want. And this is the way how it looks like. I will talk about the page load helper. This is another class that I'm creating, and it's make easier. And you can provide any condition here and just like wait until this condition will become true. And the fluent weight is almost the same as explicit weight, but here you are overall timeouts, you are waiting overall timeouts on the transaction, and additionally you need to tell that awaits that it should throw an exception, and when they don't find an object as a best practice. So, and implementation looks like, again, it's not visible, so later I will share everything so you can read it, because of the screen is not the best one. And here there is the implementation for fluent weight. You are providing a timeout. You are also providing polling every, which means how many time between the calls you need. So in explicit weight, we have a hard code. It is like 500 milliseconds. Here is adjustable. You can put that every 1 second, go and check and back. And you are handling the exception here. And this is overridden method, which is coming from the model. Sorry? I didn't catch you. Explicit weight and the this weight. Here is more dynamic. You can set the time between the calls, and also you can here you can you should actually as a best practice you should handle the Tron exception, and this one is more customizable than the explicit way. Yeah, it's the same. Yeah, you will like here what is doing, it will try to find the element that you are giving here during this time, and between the calls, like the variable that have here. So here that in apply, you are waiting for the element that you are given here, and with these parameters, you are setting it here. Yeah, it's something. It's almost the same. It's doing the same logic as a explicit weight, but with a customizable version of it. So, loadable component. He is starting the challenging part. Maybe who knows about loadable component? Oh, several of you. And so. The next question is redundant. That you, are you using in a real real project or no? It's only for you. You are using. Yep. Yep. Nice. Okay. The loadable component is a base class. Is a base class and the aim to make waiting page objects until they will. Load. So it will help us to make the page object pattern usability like less painful, and it makes more easier to debug the failures because there is a customizable stuff and lot of maintainable stuff. So there is currently an implementation in a Java that's coming to Selenium, but it's easy to implement in any other language. And for that reason, I will try to configure a custom loadable component also in a Java, which I'm doing always because I can also there provide error messages for more easy, like easier debugging and some stuff like that. So I will suggest also not use the native one, just create your own one and do anything you want. Sorry? Yeah, for that reason, there's also slow loadable component that coming to the next one. So here it's basically how you are making the class loadable. Nothing is visible, sorry. It's just extend from loadable component. And with it, there is also two methods that you always need to override when you are extending from the loadable component. It's a isLoaded and loaded. So these two methods you will implement for every page class. So this is the only, like a bit of painful part for the automation testers, who a lot of people saying that it's making a lot of work to do for every page, even I don't need. But anyway, there is no lot of good stuff without a bit more work. It will become a bit smaller, but what to do? So, demos that I will provide will be coded in Java. And as an example, I use the GitHub UI interface, and we will try to log in and try that there is exception or something like that. Everything that I will present will be applicable in strong type language, for example, if you are using a C#, and most of things will be applicable also in dynamic type languages like Ruby, Python, or something. So also in my presentations, I will use Maven, Test Engine, and for sure Selenium. So everyone has the basic knowledge of this. Yeah. So. Page object pattern. I will know again, like high level to remember what is it if someone is some out of information. It's a framework design pattern which has become popular in the Selenium test automation, and it makes easier to maintain and reduce the code duplication. This is for. As Selenium, like when we are automating like web application, and it makes easier to create page, maintain page, and whenever we would like to do it with the pages. And let's imagine we have a web application, and there is a different pages, login page, like registration page, some stuff. And in page pattern, also in the pages, there's a services like different, like specific for that page. So what we are doing, we are collecting every single page will be presented as a class. And the web page will be object. There is a classes, and every class will contain the elements with their services and the methods. So why we need to use it? This is the important question. It promotes reuse and of the code, so we'll have less code. It makes readable the whole suite. Also, it's improved maintainability, so it's easy to maintain. Makes easy to change the classes, and you will not change anything in the test class. So if you have page objects in every class name change or something that developers will change, you will change just once in one place. So how it's structured? Each page is defined its own class. Actions and are represented in the class as a method and our functions. Each function can return new page object, especially when we are navigating between the pages. Tests talks only with the page objects. Page objects, this is like extra step that I added, like with the base objects. A lot of people call that the abstract page base objects is whenever you call. And base objects talks to driver. Elements are stored as a variables. So we should make sure we should make sure that the Selenium talks only with the page objects, especially with the base class. So when we are changing something, it will be easier. So in a graphical appearance, it will look like this. So this is just a Selenium with the tests and the browsers and the report and the web application. When we are adding the page objects, so where it should be? Yeah. So we are isolating tests to be interaction with the Selenium. And another extra step that I will suggest to add, and a lot of like specialists will suggest to do, it's adding one more step between Selenium and the page objects. Like to collect everything. This is some abstract class in Java. And this is a way to make it easier to collect everything in there. So this is also a kind of a place to collect some methods that will be interacting with the Selenium. So type or finding element instead of every time calling it from driver. Because I had a problem when we were upgrading Selenium versions, so usually there is solution that should be applied to the type. So instead of going to every page objects and changing the type, we are going to the base class and changing there. So in other appearance, it will look like layers. So which one? In this graphic, you can see that the main concept is this layer should not be able to talk to with this layer. So every layer can and should talk with neighbors. There should not be any allowance to jump from that layer to the layer. This is how it looks in the packages in the Java for the Maven project. And it's a bit, again, cut it, but sorry. It's not my fault. Yep. This is basically how that page objects looks like. Here is the just example, so I hard coded the main URL. So in the real world, we are not doing this. Yes, collecting something in the property file and then reading from there to make it easier. Just being a bit more understandable and readable, I did it. And there is a constructor which is applying that driver. I will show where I am creating the driver. And here is the open page which always you will use when you are starting the test. And this is an abstract, and it can become any type of the page that you will extend it. Here, okay, for this get, maybe you have a question why there is a get. We will talk about that in a loadable component because it's done for that. And there is some abstract methods, and you can add more. So because every page will have a get URL, so we are putting in a page objects and then overriding them for the specific page. And open is already been easy. So this is the continuation of the page objects. I make it like two part to be more readable. I collected here like find, type, like different types of type, like loaded methods, click, also some several type, and some methods that you are always using. This is just for the example because I know everyone like using this, because the method of the is displayed throws exception when there is no. So this is a kind of the exception handling example, and you can add more based on your application. Here, there is a Selenium driver class, which done like high level stuff, like creating driver, and it's collected in a separate class. Here I'm just creating, I'm checking that it's not null, then creating, and I created a static method, and I can call from everywhere, which makes for me easier than always creating for every page. And I have a base test class, and every test class extends this, so as a becoming a subclass of this. And here I'm doing any stuff that done for every test. For example, after finishing class all the tests, just close the browser. Here you can add, for example, after finishing, like clear all cookies, or anything globally you want to them, because to add and repeat in the classes, I don't like, there's no make sense. So generally, this is the test that looks like this just small test that trying to log into GitHub and with the wrong credentials and shows that there is no such user and checking that exception. Not exception, but error message. So, weights in Selenium. How many of you have a problem with the weights? How many of you using the sleeps? Yeah. How many of you like using the retry? I mean, if doesn't work, retry once, always. So for the basic weights, I will generally show you which kind of the weights options can that there is in the Selenium. Then we'll talk about a loadable component, which is created for this purpose, to solve this problem. So, why we are waiting? To load the page, to make it ready, and to make the all transactions. And I always say that the sleeps, there shouldn't be sleep, because it's always making a hard time, non-adjustable. And when we are running on a continuous integration in the Amazon services, which is too expensive, we are losing a lot of money. Actually, company lose, but. So, Selenium offers like three types of the weights. Implicit weight, explicit weight, and the fluent weight. This is the three versions that you can use without anything. So implicit weight, this is the amount that you are giving to the Selenium configs, saying that every time when you are getting the any element, wait for X time, like 10 seconds. And the problem here, when there is no an element and you are checking that there shouldn't be any element, it still waits the 10 seconds. So this is not adjustable. Also, it's undocumented. It's only works for finding the elements. And you cannot customize anything. You are setting up for the driver, and it's non-visible, but it's like driver manage timeout or explicit wait, and then you are giving the wait. The best practice is to not use this. If you have possibility, if you have, you can manage without it, it's a good thing to not use this one. So, explicit wait. Here is, we have a documented and defined behavior, so you can also read in the website. This, what is, da, is doing, it's from like every 500 milliseconds, it's pinging to application, checking, pinging, checking until it will find. And it's returns success or timeout, which you can find, and works any condition you can provide. So this visible, this clickable, this should be disabled, anything you want. And this is the way how it looks like. I will talk about the page load helper. This is another class that I'm creating, and it's make easier. And you can provide any condition here and just like wait until this condition will become true. And the fluent wait is almost the same as explicit wait, but here you you are overall timeouts. You are waiting overall timeouts on the transaction, and additionally you need to tell that awaits that it should throw up exception, and when they don't find an object as a best practice. So. And implementation looks like, again, it's not visible, so later I will share everything so you can read it because of the screen is not the best one. And here there is the implementation for fluent wait. You are providing a timeout. You are also providing polling every, which means how like how many time between the calls you need. So in explicit wait, we have a hard code. It is like 500 milliseconds. Here is adjustable. You can put that every 1 second, go and check and back. And you are handling the exception here. And this is overridden method, which comes from the model. Sorry? I didn't hit you. Explicit wait and the this wait. Here is more dynamic. You can set the but the time between the calls, and also you can here you can you should actually as a best practice you should handle the thrown exception, and this one is more customizable than the explicit wait. Yeah, it's the same. Yeah, you will like here what is doing. It will try to find the element that you are giving here during this time and between the calls, like the variable that have here. So here that in apply you are waiting for the element that you are given here, and with these parameters you are setting it here. Yeah, it's something. It's almost the same. It's doing the same logic as a explicit wait, but with the customizable version of it. So, loadable component. Here is starting the challenging part. Maybe who knows about loadable component? Oh, several of you. And so. The next question is redundant, that are you using in a real real project or no? It's only for you. You are using. Yep. Yep. Nice. Okay. The loadable component is a base class. Is a base class and the aim to make waiting page objects until they will load. So it will help us to make the page object pattern usability like less painful. And it makes more easier to debug the failures because there is the customizable stuff and stuff and a lot of maintainable stuff. So there is currently an implementation in a Java that's come with Selenium, but it's easy to implement in any other language. And for that reason, I will try to configure a custom loadable component also in a Java, which I'm doing always because I can also there provide error messages for more easy, like easier debugging and some stuff like that. So I will suggest also not use the native one, just create your own one and do anything you want. Sorry? Yeah, for that reason, there's also slow loadable component that coming the next one. So here it's basically how you are making the class loadable. Nothing is visible, sorry. It's just extend from loadable component. And with it, there is also two methods that you always need to override when you are extending from the loadable component. It's a isLoaded and loaded. So these two methods you will implement for every page class. So this is the only, like a bit of painful part for the automation testers, who a lot of people saying that it's making a lot of work to do for every page, even I don't need. But anyway, there is no lot of good stuff without a bit more work. So how to use it? The pattern also allows you to model your page objects as a tree nested component, allows you better navigation between the pages, and load method we'll use during the navigation, and isLoad method we will use to determine when the page is ready to continue. This is the get method from the loadable component class. This is the native one that Java has. There is loaded. This method will come in the next slide. There's a is loaded and the loaded. So it tries check is it loaded the page, then continues, and if it's not, it calls load. So this is mostly for navigation. So usually when you are just want to check is it loaded or no, you are just making the, like you are not implementing the loaded method. And here there is the already in the page object that overrided method. This is a leave empty because I'm not trying to navigate between the pages. And here is it checks. It waits until the some element will not be clickable. So after that, when it navigates. So if no, it throws the exception. So when you are creating the page, you just need to call get. When you are calling get, it already will check the old stuff from the loadable component and you will check that is loaded conditions for you. Okay? This is the thing that I'll also put in the base object class. So here we have this, and instead of this, and also I mentioned before the about page loader helper. Instead of checking for like in this way, I'm suggesting to have a page load helper. And collect there the all helpers that you will like help you to wait until something is ready. And this is this use the invocation chain and the implementation with this kind of it will looks like this. So it's more readable and more easy to implement. So yeah, I just checked the two and you can do dot more. This one also loaded, this one is clickable, this one is disabled, and all this visibility and disabled and enabled methods you can collect in one place, and share with all page objects. So here I'm showing the implementation for the base class. So the base class extends from the loadable component, and then all your pages are extended from the base class. And here you are having the common implementation of the loadable component. You can see that there is a custom loadable component, which means that I use the custom one. So let's check. Ah, okay, I forget show. This is the get. So in this implementation, it when you are creating it any page object, it always will go through the get. So it will check is loaded or no. In that case, you will have an exception. It's coming. So in the native implementation, there is no that exception stuff. It's just catching something. When you are creating, you can define anything also you want, like timeout or some stuff like that. And also you can use the exception handling for the method, and for debugging you will have more possibility. Other page, yeah. Just when you are navigating, then you are returning new page, yes? Like return new, another page, dot get. When you are doing new, you are calling get. Because we can like be sure that everyone comes from base object, and base objects comes from loadable component, and it should implement also get. So this is the way how you can implement in any language also. And here you can do anything you want. This is just the example. You can make it more debuggable for you. Slow loadable component is almost the same, but this is waiting exactly for the components. This is better for use when you have a lot of Ajax calls and you want to wait for the Ajax call. This is a subclass of loadable component. It has get. Additionally, it has also wait for and is error methods. So after a call load, the is loaded method will continue to fail until component will be loaded. This is the main difference with a loadable component. Okay, here there is also you are providing a time also. When you are extending from the slow loadable component, you have to implement also the you will implement the superclass constructor, and you will provide a time. And the clock. So it's basically looks like slow loadable component. So it shouldn't be on the base object. It should be for the page, exactly for the component, and I just make it shorter. And you, in your constructor, you should call this like super constructor, which is like needs some system clock and the time. The time, it's the time, how many time it should try, and the clock, and it's the time that it's trying to get several times, yes, until it will be true. So, any questions so far, so good? I'm running a bit faster because we don't have a time, because we start a bit late to not disrupt also others. But if you have a question, later we will, yep. Any condition that you can think, you are open-minded, you can open your creativity. Any condition that you want to check, you are putting it in, is loaded, with wait until like frame will be loaded or something in the frame like will be accessible or something will be disabled or enabled inside the frame. So anything that you can think, you can apply there that needs to be checked after the creating the instance. Sorry?
I have a drop-down, a country drop-down, which has a lot of values, India, Australia, UK, USA, something like that. So my page is loaded, but the drop-down values are not loaded. It is sometimes it takes some little bit of microseconds or seconds to load. So, but my XPath is pointing to the value, not to the element. There are two ways of doing it. Driver.find element, go to element, that is country, and select the value or India or
you
something
can
like that.
Also do like wait until this element will have this value. Or generally wait until the element will have a value. So you can get the element, get the value, and check that it's not null, it's not empty.
You can try a parent class and wait until that object compared with the child objects.
This will become a try.
Yeah.
So with a loadable component, we are not trying because loadable component will try itself.
Yeah.
So but you are giving that only condition and asking the loadable component just continue when this is true and it will wait for you. You don't need to make a loop. You don't need to make a try. You're just giving the condition. And the loadable or the slow loadable component instead of you will try to do something.
Right, right. Yep. Yeah. That is what I was about to say.
Yep.
There are some things that need trigger. And after trigger, you have to wait. So what you can do over here is you can look for that object and you can wait. Your wait condition can be dependent on the child objects or the child classes.
Mm-hmm.
That way I have implemented in my page object model.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also option. So
yeah, it's also an option and it is quite time saving. That is what my observation is.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's go through also the common failures, then we will use the rest of time for the question and answer. So common failures, usually people who says me, I tried the Selenium, it doesn't work for our project, we will not use that. And the first question I'm always asking, you use the Selenium ID with the Selenium 1?
Yes.
So don't use it. I'm working with the Selenium already like 7 years. I never recorded a test, even when we were working with the Selenium 1. It's like some untidy code that is fast only for the first stage. After that, you will crash everything. So using the only Selenium 1 with the recording stuff will always fail when you have like amount of the tests. Not building a framework. Not building a framework, it means that people using the Selenium just from the test, they are driver, click, driver, open, driver, do, driver, that. Which is will fail when you have like more than 1,000 tests, so you will for sure fail. Use unique selectors. This is a bit challenging for the Selenium, but the thing that I'm trying to never use that XPath. Because XPath is too slow in the Internet Explorer. And when the position is changed, your tests are failing. So use the IDs, which are unique, or the class names, if are unique. The people usually say that there is what if there is no ID or something like that. My approach is just work with the developers. So push developers to add unique stuff. Automation also development. So it's not a secondary project. I know that in most cases they are saying, do whatever you want. So it shouldn't be the case. You are also a developer. You should also work with the software developer, push them to add unique stuff, and make this like more stability in your tests. And also another case in this topic, I'm always pushing developers to get familiar with the tests. They are not supposed to write, but they should be aware how it's working. So when they are making changes, so they should understand that it can break, given not like early notify a notification or doing like fixing themselves. Do not use the retries. You will fail when you have 1,000 tests and you are running on the server's clouds. One day you will fail, even if it works for you now. Do not try automate things that are not automatable. Okay? Basically, theoretically, everything you can automate. If not with Selenium, with other frameworks. But don't try to do that, because sometimes it's easier to check from like every regression cycle. So having someone, some manual tester and someone to check it like during the half an hour for every release, then automate everything, spending some days for implementation and spending some hours for the maintaining them. So it's better to not automate like lots of stuff. And run your automation tests sometimes. If you have a suite, run them, break them, fix them, do everything you want, but just run them. Not wait for a 6 months and then find out that there's no tests are passing in your environment. So the breaking the builds and fixing the builds, the most fun part of the automation. So, yep. So we are running. Yes, we are running out of the time. Just if you have any question, I will be here till the end of the Sunday. We can talk. We can try to go together. We can try to find a solution for your problems and whenever you want. Sorry? It's my name, surname. Visible? Tom? Thank you for coming. Thank you, organizers, for making the opportunity. And enjoy the rest of the conference. See you somewhere in the lobby.